Beautiful. Thank you for that. Good morning.
Good morning.
Wasn't that beautiful? Sometimes we sort of pay attention, sometimes we don't, and we realize there's just something beautiful happening in the background, and that's Amy and Joetta, the beautiful background. That's what we could call you if you had your own thing, beautiful background. No, that's not good. We are here to worship God, and we use this room and this building, but we're the people, the church of God. Is that right? We're glad that you're here this morning, and if you're here for the first time, we're especially glad because we're always praying for new people to love, new people to meet, and so Blacksburg Baptist Church, if you see someone you don't recognize, consider that a new person. Introduce yourself, greet them, welcome them, make sure they don't feel like a visitor or a guest, but and certainly not a stranger, but like family. And if you will, please, if you're here for the first time, you'll see this Connect card in your bulletin. Take just a second to fill out the information that you want us to have, and we won't use that to stalk you and be creepy, but we'll use it to know you and pray for you and to respond to you and let you know that we're here if you have a need and if you have any questions about who we are at Blacksburg Baptist Church, who we're striving to be in Jesus Christ. So we're just so glad you're here, and we hope that you'll experience God in such a way today with the family of God that you want to come back. I've met several visitors all morning long, and that just makes me very, very glad. And so please, please keep coming. Read your bulletin. I'm not going to read it to you, but just a couple of things. One being we have 45 backpacks left. Right, Charlotte?
Yep, I'm right here.
There you are. Right, Charlotte? 45 backpacks left, and unless, you know, in the first two services, someone adopted a few. So make sure we get that done. How many weeks do we have? How much longer?
We have to turn everything in by July 29th.
By July 29th, that has to be done. So it's a wonderful ministry of love. And so go by the front entrance there by the offices, and you'll see how you can adopt someone with a backpack, okay? We're glad that Sarah and leaders and youth are back all together from the Dominican Republic, and they have lots of stories of God at work there. God's going to be at work here because of his work there, already is. And Sarah, we're looking forward to hearing from you and the youth about all those God stories and what's next, because relationships are being built and partnerships, right? So thank you. God answered our prayers about health and safety and all that. We have so many reasons to be glad and to be thankful. We also have burdens. We have concerns. You have some that are personal, and we collectively have some burdens as a church family. We continue to remember Steve McGlamory and the death of his mother just a week ago, and the healing process, the recovery process that is ongoing for Steve and his family. Certainly we continue, Rick, to pray for your mother and your father and for you as you're loving your mother and ministering to her in her last days. Only God knows how long any of us has. We want to pray for some other folks who will not be named, who experienced tremendous grief in loss this week and some even last night, just immeasurable kinds of losses. And so we will bring our praises to God and our burdens all at once as we worship him and trust him. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we do trust you to hear our prayers and to care in a way that nobody else ever has or will. We trust you to know what to do with our needs, how to meet them, what to do with our burdens and concerns, how to ease them. Lord Jesus, we certainly know and hope that you'll be pleased with our praise, with our worship today. You are our audience of one. Help us to be mindful of you. Not so much mindful of ourselves or even the people beside us. Not so much mindful of our schedule the week ahead. But help us in this hour to be mindful of you and to truly worship you in spirit and in truth. Help us to understand more today about this freedom you have achieved for us. Freedom that truly sets us free. We give this worship to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Janet has something to do. Come on up here.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Janet Hare, and as Chair of the Deacons, I am very pleased to announce this morning another 10-year staff anniversary for one of Blacksburg Baptist's staff. Nelson, come on up. This is... Yeah. This is Nelson Best, for anyone who doesn't know him. Nelson has been working here at the church for 10 years now as building superintendent. He's behind the scenes guy. He takes care of the church and all the other facilities and gets them ready for us so that when we need them, they're ready to use. We have a certificate to give Nelson today, a certificate of appreciation, and also a token of our appreciation. And everyone, when you see Nelson, please be sure to thank him, and let's give him a big round of applause for 10 years.
You told me that you wanted to give a speech, didn't you? Didn't you want to say that? Nelson loves to be up in front of everybody and to say something. Would you like, the mic is on, would you like to say something? Yeah, you're going to kill me tomorrow, aren't you? Yeah. Love you, Nelson. Love you for 10 years. I'll love you for another 10, probably, okay? We're glad you're here. Nelson has saved us thousands of dollars over the years, too. He's one of those guys that can do anything. Like my dad, just do anything, fix anything, you know, figure it out. I'm not that guy, so thank you. I've asked you for 10 years to teach me how to be that guy, but you can't do it. I think you're afraid of job security or something. So anyway, thank you so much, Nelson. Hey, we're going to stand, we're going to greet each other, and the children are going to come forward for Miss Lumley and hear about freedom, okay? Let's stand and greet each other, not necessarily with a holy kiss, but a holy handshake at least.
Did for 4th of July? Anybody see any fireworks? You did? How was that? Did anybody get to light any sparklers? Did anybody eat any super yummy like hamburgers and hot dogs? I know I did. Yeah, there we go. Awesome! Oh, I'm so glad you guys had a fun 4th of July and a good week. So do you guys remember what we talked about last week up here? We talked about, I want to see if any of y'all remember. Do y'all remember what we talked about? Starts with an F and ends with freedom. Freedom, that's right. We talked about freedom in Christ and how when Jesus died on the cross with us, he made us free. But when you guys hear the word free, like if you're at the store or at school or on the playground, what do you guys typically think of? If you hear the word free.
Huh? Free as in wild or something?
Oh yeah, you can do whatever you want, woo! Have fun, having fun, and yeah, there you go. Anybody else? How about if you go to the store and you hear something is free? Does that mean it doesn't cost anything? You can just, yeah, there you go. Well, the freedom we have in Christ was not free. It cost him his whole life. Did you know that? It cost him his whole life. He gave his whole life so we could have freedom in him. But how do we get this freedom? Can I take my debit card and go to the store and buy that freedom? If I read 10,000 books this week, does that give me freedom in Christ? If I do 157 nice things for people, does that give him Christ? To give us freedom in Christ? What gives us freedom in Christ? It's when we accept him into our hearts and we love him and we love people and when we repent of our sins. That's what makes us free in Christ, and it gives us that freedom to live for him. So are we going to live for Christ this week, and are we going to be so glad that he made us free? Awesome. Okay, let's pray, guys. Jesus, thank you for that freedom that costs so much, but that you freely give to us. We love you, and we just pray that this week we will never take that for granted. We love you so much. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. It is so good to see you today. This morning we are going to sing and celebrate the free gift of God's grace that is greater than all of our sins, that wonderful grace of Jesus. Will you stand? Lift your voices with us as we sing.
Wonderful grace of Jesus, greater than all my sin. How shall my tongue describe it? Where shall the praise begin? Taking away my burden, setting my spirit free. For the wonderful grace of Jesus reaches me.
Your grace,
your grace,
your grace. My sin and shame, here to set us free.
Your grace,
I thank you, Lord, for your grace. For all my days, I thank you for your grace.
Your grace,
your grace.
thank you, Lord, for your grace. I don't deserve it.
That gift of grace is free to us, but Jesus paid the ultimate price. We can't repay it, but we can love, praise, follow, and serve him. That is amazing grace. Amen?
Amen.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing. All that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yes. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you should take my place. That you would bear my cross. For me, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you should take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down. All that you've done for me.
Everlasting God, we worship you. You are our life, our breath, our hope, and our peace. We run to you, Lord. You are the reason that we sing.
You are good, you are good. When there's nothing good in me, you are love, on display for all to see. You are light, when the darkness closes in. You are hope, you have covered all my sin. You are peace, when my fear is crippling. You are true, even in my wandering. You are joy, you're the reason that I sing. You are life, in your death has lost its sting. Oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign. Jesus, my heart will sing. No other name, Jesus, Jesus, my heart will sing. No other name, Jesus, Jesus, my heart will sing. No other name, Jesus, Jesus.
Join me in prayer. Father God, we come into this place humbled and privileged to be called children of God. And this morning, so incredibly aware that the God that loves us and cherishes us and gives generously to us in Blacksburg, Virginia, loves and gives generously to your children in all corners of the globe. Many of us made new friends in Puerto Plata, Dominican Republic, the past 2 weeks. And God, this morning, you are loving them just as deeply. You are as present with them as you are here in this place where your spirit is moving. God, the riches of your love are enough. And as we continue to be people that learn more about what it means to be enough, there's never enough joy or laughter. We can always use more. We can always multiply. We can always multiply freedom and generosity and kindness. And yet, God, the things that we so often think we need to work hard for aren't the things that are our enough. As we continue to worship you this morning, we just pray that our hearts are changed ever more into your likeness, ever more to reflect your Son, Jesus, whose name is above all other names. God, thank you for being good to us. Help us in turn to be good to one another and to be hands and feet outside of the walls of Blacksburg Baptist. We love you, Lord. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh, so beautiful, right? Oh my goodness, thank you, Amy. Be thou my vision, Lord of my heart. What a good prayer for all of us today. If he were our sole and primary vision, wow, wouldn't life be different? Wouldn't life be freer? Hey, speaking of freedom, happy freedom. I hope you did enjoy the holiday on Wednesday. Raise your hand if you had to work. Yeah, Christian, we know you worked, son. Yeah, Adam, you had to work, yeah. But I hope that you were able to enjoy some time with family. And if you were here last week, this will make sense. If you weren't here, it won't. I did not blow anything or anybody up. No injuries, and everything's safe. And I hope you had a really good day of celebration, celebrating freedom. Before Wednesday, July 4th, though, we had already begun talking about freedom, if you remember, if you were here last week, and we're in search of true freedom. Not the freedom the world promises and offers to us, but true freedom, ultimate freedom, lasting freedom. And we agree, Christians, that we find that kind of freedom only in Jesus the Christ. And you've already heard that this morning in music and in children's time. And thank you, Lindsay, for sharing that truth with the children. I love the young man's idea that freedom is about running wild. You weren't able to hear him. We need to mic these children, and sometimes maybe we don't. But his idea freedom was running wild. We celebrated our freedom from tyranny and oppressive monarchies and unaccountable sovereignties on Wednesday. As a church, though, we are celebrating something much greater, and a freedom that is so true and so liberating. It gives us far more than happiness. It gives us joy. And you know, joy is so much greater than happiness, because happiness is dependent on circumstances going my way. But joy is that lasting, grounding kind of experience of contentment and peace that only Jesus brings and promises to those who trust him and follow him. I hope that we left the sanctuary last Sunday understanding better what freedom truly is and what it isn't. I hope we left the sanctuary understanding what the gospel is and what the gospel isn't. You know, that was the Apostle Paul's wish for us, goal for us, is that as we study the book of Galatians, the letter he wrote to the churches at Galatia, we would understand what the true gospel is, that is the good news of salvation in Jesus Christ, life in Jesus, abundant and eternal. That's the good news, right? That we would understand what it is and what it is not. I heard from some folks that day on Sunday as they left here feeling free and released, and I heard some from some folks over the week, and so we praise God for that freedom. I hope maybe you're one of them, and if not this past week, maybe this is the week that you understand and experience and are able to live in absolute freedom. I think we continue, even as Christians, to distort and exaggerate the idea of freedom and to detach it constantly from biblical understandings, biblical truth. And again, we agree that Jesus is our lens for interpreting all of the Bible, right? If we want to understand what the Bible is teaching us, if we want to understand truth, and certainly if we want to understand freedom, then Jesus Christ is our lens. His life, how he lived, and how he taught us to live, his death, how and why he died, and his resurrection, proof of which we enjoy in eyewitness testimonies here in our Bible, and then eyewitness testimonies across the years. You're an eyewitness testimony if the Spirit of the living Christ has changed your life. Do you know that? You're a living testament, proof of the resurrection. We tend to still speak of freedom in abstract terms, folks, kind of like the rest of the world does, even though we're not supposed to be like the world and speak like the world. We speak of freedom like the world does, and we allow room for it to mean many things to many people. Sometimes we even allow enough room for it to mean anything to all people. And if it means anything to all people, then it's not really freedom, it's not really truth at all. So very often, Christians, we're playing it safe, aren't we? And we're being very careful, and we're being very correct, because we're afraid of all kinds of things, that fear factor. You're afraid of judgment, when in fact God is calling us out to freely, freely speak and live the truth, who is Jesus Christ himself. It is not freedom, some subjective abstract at all, but rather it's something very, very specific, very, very specific, fully defined and displayed in the work of Jesus the Christ. And Paul, as he continues his letter to the churches in Galatia, makes it clear again to us today, even simple. Who votes for simple? Anybody vote for simple? I'm always looking to simplify things, folks. And so maybe that makes me simple. But I'm always trying to take that which seems complicated and simplify it. Not just for somebody else, but for myself. And in our scripture passage today, Paul's trying to do that. But there's something we're not going to like, because Paul ends in this passage with telling us this about freedom. True freedom, apparently, has everything to do with change. True freedom means there's going to be a change. And a lot of us don't like change. Galatians chapter 1, verse 11. Dear brothers and sister, Paul writes, I solemnly assure you that the good news of salvation, that is the gospel which I preach, is not based on mere human reasoning or logic. For my message came by a direct revelation from Jesus Christ himself. No one else taught me. You know what I was like when I followed the Jewish religion, how I violently persecuted the Christians. I did my best to get rid of them. I was one of the most religious Jews of my own age, and I tried hard as possible to follow all the old traditions of my religion. Paul's talking about his life as a religious man before his life in relationship with God and Jesus Christ. Verse 15 is pivotal. Listen. But then, Paul says, but then something happened. For it pleased God in his kindness to choose me and call me even before I was born. What undeserved mercy, what grace. Then he revealed his son to me so that I could proclaim the good news about Jesus to the Gentiles. When all this happened to me, I did not rush out to consult with anyone else, nor did I go up to Jerusalem to consult with those who were apostles before I was. I just love Paul, don't you? No, I went away into Arabia and returned later to the city of Damascus. It was not until 3 years later that I finally went to Jerusalem for a visit with Peter and stayed there with him for 15 days. And the only other apostle I met at that time was James, our Lord's brother. You must believe what I'm saying, for I declare before God that I'm not lying, Paul says. Then after this visit, I went north into the provinces of Syria and Cilicia, and still the Christians in the churches in Judea didn't know me personally. Listen to this. All they knew, says Paul, was that people were saying this: the one who used to persecute us now preaches the very faith he tried to destroy. And they gave glory to God because of the change in me. Now that's a lot, I know. Paul says a lot every time he grabs hold of a pen. And he has very, very, very long sentences. Just remember, this was written in real time by a real man who had a real experience with the real and living Christ, and it's been preserved for us thousands of years. It's not just ancient history. This is living, and it's breathing, and it has everything to do with today. If we listen and we cast away our fear of change, it has everything to do with you and me today. Independence. We love independence. It starts really, really early. Parents, you remember the first time your child learned to say no. You remember the first time your child pulled away and wanted to do something on her own or by himself, right? Oh, those are some of the first words that children learn. And it continues from just after the cradle all the way to the grave. I was visiting in a Richmond hospital years and years ago, and there was this elderly woman who was needing the help of her son, at that time probably in his mid-50s. He's trying to help his mama. His mama didn't want help, and she pulled, as I'm watching at the threshold of the doorway, she pulled her arm away. She said, I'll do it myself. Mother, you need my help. No, I don't. I'll do it myself. And I remember thinking at that time, there was a time about 50 years earlier that mama was a young woman and that son was a little boy and probably pulling away from mama saying, I'll do it myself. Or as my niece used to say, I'll do it myself, my fels. I would do it my fels. Right? And I just got sad and glad all in the same moment that life was coming full circle. Now he's trying to help her and she's being doggedly independent. Folks, independence is a good thing, but independence has limits. Here's the truth. You and I don't really do anything by ourselves. Do you know that? We don't really do anything by ourselves. We don't really do anything that matters on our own. Freedom is not some existential idea for me to figure out on my own or by myself. We figure this out in community, and God's Word gives us the definitions. Paul says it's not human logic, it's not moral or ethical or religious reasoning that gets us to the truth of freedom. Freedom is God's idea. And if it's God's idea, then we have to bow to God's definition and God's understanding of freedom. And we have to understand that it's God's gift to creation. We talk about freedom as a right. You know, everybody's talking about, I have a right, I have a right, I have a right. I'm a little tired of hearing that. Freedom in Christ is God's gift to creation. If we agree there's a creator and a creation and we are creatures, and we agree that that creator is limitless in his power, in his knowledge, in his ability to do anything, then we must also agree that we have limits. We are limited creatures, but we pretend that freedom is absolute and limitless, and folks, that's dangerous. Absolute, limitless freedom leads straight to anarchy, and that leads to the collapse of all freedom. That leads to utter chaos and powers of war. You see, the great paradox of true freedom is that it can only be truly known and held and enjoyed within the parameters that God sets. We can only be free within limits. Now you might think, well, Todd, that just doesn't sound like freedom at all. That doesn't sound like the freedom the world teaches us about. But the world lies to us all the time. Freedom in Christ has boundaries. Freedom in Christ has limits. I'll give you some practical examples of limits to our freedom. We would not be fully free to drive if there were no traffic laws. Now, someone's fantasizing and getting excited right now about no traffic laws. Is that exciting to anyone? I don't get that because I don't speed. I don't break the traffic laws. You may speed and enjoy that. Jeremy, you laughed the last time. You laughed again. I do dream that maybe there's a day when there are no traffic laws, no speed limits. Would that be fun to anybody? Now, come on. To somebody, that would be fun. I know it's dangerous. I didn't ask you if it's right or safe. I asked you if it'd be fun. Well, certainly that would not be freedom. It would be terribly dangerous. We would not be freely communicating this morning outside the rules of the English language. Vocabulary. We are dependent on vocabulary, grammar, and syntax. If I were not speaking within the English vocabulary and grammar and syntax, it would be absolute gibberish. How about music? Music is a language all its own, right? Outside the notes, the notations of the music, the rules of music, there is no beautiful music at all. There's no harmony. It's only dissonance, and we do not want to hear that. I'm absolutely free to go to the piano or go to the organ right now and play either one. Would you like to hear me? Let me tell you. Yeah. No, you really don't. Just because I can do something does not mean I should. Right? Just because I can does not mean that I should do it. I can't play the piano or the organ. I wish I could. And if I tried, I would find maybe I weren't so free because Charlotte or someone would probably stop me. Right? Folks, just because I can do it doesn't mean I should do it. I need to understand the limits of freedom, and only Jesus can help me understand where the safe limits are, where the righteous boundaries are to my freedom and your freedom. Only Jesus rescues the concept of freedom from the abstract, egocentric, anything goes illusion we've made it out to be and makes it real. He makes it freedom worth fighting for. He makes it a freedom worth dying for. He makes it a freedom worth living in and for. Jesus said in John 8:32, you know this, we were here last week and it's one of my favorite promises from Jesus, then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. We love that because we want to know the truth and we want to be free, but we often overlook the preceding verse. Does anybody know what Jesus said in verse 31? He said this, if you keep obeying my teachings, you are truly my disciples. Then you will know the truth and the truth will set you free. You see, there's a contingency plan, it seems. There's an if-then clause to true freedom in Jesus Christ. If you keep obeying my teachings, then you'll really know the truth, and then you'll really be free. It's not merely knowing the truth, folks, but it's doing the truth. We can gather in this room, and we can have Bible study after Bible study and agree on the right beliefs and doctrine and truth, and if we don't leave this place and live that truth, do what we've taught, we're not, says Jesus, true disciples, and we're not going to know the truth, and we're not going to be free. James 1:22 says this, don't just be listeners of the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. We vote yes for that, right? Here's my problem. Romans 7:19. I want to do what is right, but I don't. I don't want to do what is wrong, but I do it anyway. Does anybody else have that problem? No, Todd, it's just you. Everybody pray for me, okay? I want to do what's right, and I know what's right, but I don't do it. And I don't want to do what's wrong, and I know it's wrong, but I do it anyway. Why? Because I'm selfish and self-centered and prideful and sinful and human and all that. Any Andy Griffith fans in the house today? Andy Griffith fans? Yeah. So one of my favorite characters is Otis. Don't you love Otis? So Otis is that guy in town who has some problems, some frequent problems. And he likes beverages and libations and, you know. Otis checks himself in and out of the jail like a Super 8 motel. I mean, he walks in and he gets the key. He puts himself in jail. When it's time and he's sobered up, he gets the key. And Andy says, you can go home. He unlocks the jail and he puts the key on the hook. Otis cracks me up. But as I think about Otis, I'm kind of like Otis. You don't need to worry about me so much, but this is what I do. Todd, I didn't know. I walk in and out of freedom all the time. I walk in and out of jail all the time. I claim freedom and I talk about it and I preach about it and I celebrate and I help other people celebrate. And then I find myself, like I did this last week after preaching about freedom, not acting free at all and putting myself in jail and acting like I'm still bound by the chains of my former self. And the Holy Spirit convicted me and said, Todd, are you free or not? Do you believe what I gave you to preach or not? Are you Otis or not? I started to laugh and then I cried because it really wasn't funny when I realized that I'm Otis. Why do we do that? We walk in and out of freedom, in and out of jail, as if we're holding the keys. Folks, we do not hold the keys to our freedom. Who does? Jesus. Jesus and He alone holds the key to my freedom and yours. So here's a tip. When God delivers you from evil, don't keep in touch. Right? Doesn't that make sense? When God delivers you from evil, and if you're like me, He delivers you over and over again, don't keep in touch. Don't look back. Move forward. So I didn't used to because I'm a man and I have a good sense of direction, but I got lost a couple times, and so now I use navigational devices when I drive. And I love Google Maps. And I have a relationship with Siri that my wife is aware of, okay? And Siri tells me every time I take a wrong turn, proceed to the route. Does she tell you that? Proceed to the route. What she's basically saying is, dummy, get back on track. Turn around, right? Folks, I tell you what. If freedom is about change, then change is about repentance. Change is about repentance, and repentance is a church word that we don't use very often because we consider it ugly, but it's a very lovely, liberating kind of word. It means changing course. It means turning around. It means going in a new direction. It means proceeding to the root, getting back on course, back on the path. I think it's kind of funny, but it's only been funny to me all morning long. I'm going to say it in hopes that you find it funny too. What if Siri said to me every time I took a wrong turn instead of proceed to the root, repent, repent? Funny to just a few. Okay, I should have just ditched it altogether. I think that would be funny if my phone yelled, repent, repent. That's what it means. Get back on course. Turn around. Move in God's direction. But I'm afraid of losing my freedom if I become a Christian. People tell me that. I don't want the church telling me what to do and what not to do. What right does the church have to tell me what to do? I'm tired of Christians imposing their beliefs on me. That's what I hear from people. If we're imposing our beliefs on people and telling people what to do and not to do, we're not being true disciples. We're not living freely and handing freedom off. What if we change the narrative? What if we change their perceptions of us, of the church, of the living Christ? Finish this verse for me, John 13:35. They will know you are Christians, A, by your religious beliefs, B, by your church doctrine, C, by your constitution, bylaws. I have to pause there. Some kind of vote for that sometimes. D, say it with me, by your love. What if we just were loving people? Oh, Todd, that sounds like you're getting ready to hug a tree or something. What if we were just loving people? and not so caught up in religiosity and rules and legalisms, etc. They will know you belong to me by your love. They will know me by your love. Outside the truth of God in Christ Jesus, the world proves itself far less liberating than what it promises to be, because only God gives freedom that is free. Only Jesus does that. But let's not forget, this freedom cost him absolutely everything. Amen? My freedom cost him everything, and I don't take that seriously enough, often enough. There's no real freedom apart from the gospel found in Jesus Christ, the good news of salvation. And that's why we're here today, to know more about that, to love it more, appreciate it more, cherish it more. Across all time, all generations, all cultures, all people, they've been on a quest for more. They want to know who God is, going back before written history. They want to get to God, reach God. They want to find the meaning of life and the portal to the next. Quest for more. Here's the paradox. It turns out that more is found here with less. More is found in a simple gathering, at a simple table, with a very simple meal, bread and a cup, with simple, ordinary people at the table. Well, all but one. Jesus was the only one at the first supper that we now call the Last Supper that would produce a change in this world that the world hasn't seen since. It would be the first time at that supper, not the first time they had ever met and gathered for a simple meal, but the first time that he would talk about his death and that he would symbolize his death. And this bread is my body, and it's going to be given and broken for you. And this cup is my blood. It's going to be shed for the forgiveness of your sins. It wasn't the meal that changed everything. It's what happened after the meal. It's what happened to them after the meal because of what happened to Jesus. No, nothing happened to Jesus. Jesus was not a victim. Because of what Jesus did after the meal we call the Last Supper, the disciples would be changed forevermore, free forevermore. And I have to wonder today, as we come to the table of communion, what will happen to us today after the meal? What do you mean, Todd? Nothing. We'll go home. We'll eat lunch. Sometimes it's ritual. Sometimes it's routine. What if today's different? What if today something happens to me, happens to you? What if I'm changed by this meal today because I allow the Spirit of God to really move me and change me and make a difference? And what if when I leave here, I'm not the same, like Paul was not the same, and people notice I'm not the same, and then that makes a change in them and a change in others, and the world begins to change? What if it all starts with a very simple meal? And it ends up changing the world. You remember Paul said, they didn't even know me personally. All they knew was that people were saying, this dude is totally different than he was before. Folks, if I'm a true disciple, follower of Jesus, I'm going to be different and the world's going to notice. Maybe you've not trusted Christ before as Lord and Savior, and today's the day you want to do that and walk into freedom. Maybe you've trusted Christ, but you've been walking in and out of jail, in and out of freedom, and you want to stop. You want to drop your chains and not pick them back up and be free, not just for your sake, but for the sake of people around you. Today's the day. Today's the day. Jesus is ready and willing and waiting. Let's pray about it. Holy God, thank you for freedom. Thank you, oh, for the price that you paid for our freedom. Oh, such a price. Way too expensive for me, I know, and yet grace says it's mine. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your gift of grace. Help us to trust you today. Help us to understand freedom. Grab hold of it as you've grabbed hold of us. Help us to live in it and love it and proclaim it and not walk in and out of it. Lord, help us to drop our chains today and be free, whatever that means for everybody, anybody in the room. Lord Jesus, set us free. Set me free. In a way that changes me and changes this world. From death to life, from grace to grace. In Jesus' name, amen.
How precious is my Savior's blood. The beauty of heaven wrapped in my shame. The image of love upon death's frame. If having my heart was worth the pain, what joy could you see beyond the grave? If love found my soul worth dying for, how wonderful, how glorious, my Savior's scars, victorious. My chains are gone, my debt is paid, from death to life, and grace. If heaven now owns that vacant tomb, how great is the hope that lives in you. The passion that tore through hell like a rose. The promise that rolled back death and its stone. If freedom is worth the life you raised, oh, where is my sin? Where is my shame? If love paid it all to have my heart, how wonderful, how glorious, my Savior's scars, victorious, my chains are gone. My debt is paid, from death to life, and grace to grace. When I see that cross, I see freedom. When I see that grave, I see Jesus. And from death to life, I will sing your praise in the wonder of your grace. When I see that cross, I see freedom. When I see that grave, I see Jesus. And from death to life, I will sing your praise in the wonder of your grace. When I see that cross, I see freedom. When I see that grave, I see Jesus. And from death to life, I will sing your praise. Oh, I'll sing your praise.
I see that cross, I see freedom.
When I see that grave, I see Jesus. And from death to life, I will sing your praise. In the wonder of your grace, how my soul will sing your praise. In the wonder of your grace, how my soul will sing your praise. How wonderful, how glorious, my Savior's scars, victorious. My chains are gone, my debt is paid, from death to life, and grave to grave. How wonderful, how glorious, my Savior's scars, victorious. My chains are gone. My debt is paid. From death to life, and grace to grace.
Thank you. Oh my, all that's left is, yeah, go ahead, come on. So all that's left is for anybody who's ready for a change to come to the table. And it'll work best and most quickly if you go that way to the side aisles, come to the table, and then make your way back to your seat down the center aisle. There are going to be deacons here at the tables, one at each table, just in case anybody needs any help. And I hope that you received a chain when you came in. If you didn't, we have extra chains up here. Oh my goodness. The lyrics of that song, my chains are gone, my debt is paid, from death to life, from grace to grace. As you make your way to the table of communion, contemplate, meditate on what that means, and then if and only if you're ready for that change that freedom in Christ brings, drop your chains right there. I've been listening to the sound of freedom all morning, and it sounds like that. Who knew? Amy's going to play, and you come. Start now, stepping out and coming for freedom. Thank you. early church to have this meal and to remember and celebrate and then leave singing spiritual songs. It's become our tradition too. Charlotte's going to lead us as we sing the Lord's Prayer. Thank you, Charlotte. I think I'm going to hear the sound of freedom all day long, the chains dropping. Now, if the Lord has set you free, and He has, then let's go and be free, and let's be aware of the captives who are out there who are still chained up to this world, and let's set them free. You've been anointed just to do that by Jesus Christ Himself. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you in His perfect peace and freedom as your minds are fixed on Him. Amen. And bless you.